Now we have the final bonus episode, consisting of just one game, Grand Theft Auto 3. This is not just the last of the games I recorded back in 2018 for me to make a video out of, it was the last of those games I recorded. I finished off recording this game on October 17th, 2018 and took a break until January of the next year, where I recorded the Castlevania playthrough covered in my very first video. I'd played a tiny bit of the original Grand Theft Auto on PCs a couple times when I was 9, but didn't really think about it that much. It wasn't until a few months later and staying with my dad for the weekend that I saw this in my uncle's PS2 and gave it a go. I hadn't played anything like it at the time. We barely ever tried to play the game properly, going through the story and all that. The entire family would just huddle around the TV, causing chaos and taking turns each time someone got wasted. While I did have a couple attempts of playing through the game's story, I never got too far. My brother managed to go through it at least once, but before this playthrough, the only GTA games I'd completed the stories of were Vice City and 4, with Vice City being the only one I 100%ed before this playthrough. One last thing before I start. Since this game's soundtrack is about 99% licensed music played on the car radios, to avoid copyright bollocks, I'll be using music from other games, just like I have been in videos of movie licensed games that use the film score. We start late at night where the Liberty City Bank is being robbed by our silent protagonist Claude and his girlfriend Catalina. Catalina turns on Claude and shoots him, leaving him for the police. After his conviction, we see Claude being transported to prison. On the Callahan Bridge, the police convoy is attacked, giving Claude and fellow prisoner 8-Ball the chance to escape. The attacker is also left behind a bomb to blow up a chunk of the bridge. This automatically puts me to the game's first mission, Give Me Liberty. 8-Ball knows a place they can lay low in the red light district, but his hands are messed up so I have to drive. I have to follow the blip on the radar in the bottom left of the screen to reach the hideout. You can tell here it had been 5 years since I'd last played a GTA game because I'm all over the place crashing into everything. I'll also probably be brightening up footage at night like in my Dynasty Warriors 2 video just so you can see what's even going on. I'm only leaving that sentence in the script to ensure that I do it. I reach the red light district and drive into this alley, stopping in the blue mark. The two get out of the car and get changed. At this hideout I can save and store a single car in the garage that will stay after saving and turn the game off. Claude and 8-Ball get back in the car and he tells us about a guy he knows named Luigi, who can get Claude work. Also at the hideout is a free baseball bat. My car's pretty messed up at this point so I try to drive carefully to Luigi's, which is just around the corner. But I nudge one traffic light too many and the car catches fire and explodes, killing 8-Ball. I failed the tutorial mission. I feel quite the shame at using the game's only mid-mission checkpoint, which starts me back at the hideout. Like the game is really showing pity on me. Next time I manage to avoid the stationary traffic light and stop outside Luigi's club. This starts the next mission, Luigi's Girls. 8-Ball goes in alone to talk to Luigi. Luigi comes out with a job for me. I need to pick up Misty, one of his girls, from a clinic and bring her back. There'll be more work for me if I can manage this simple task. I get in the car and follow the green blip on the map. It's not very far to the clinic in Portland View. I'll be seeing this place a lot as it's where I reload when I die. Misty gets in the car and the drive back to the club goes without incident. Mission passed and I get $1,500. I have more missions to do with Luigi, marked on the minimap with the big L. He can wait though, because I'm getting a lot of side stuff out of the way first. First thing I'm going to go for is Portland's hidden packages. There's 100 in the game with a reward for every 10 I collect. I pull up a map and guide to find them and pause the game to see where I am on the in-game map. I go through all the tabs and where's the map? This is something I completely forgot about. Having the entire game map in the pause menu wasn't added until Vice City. So all I have to work with is what I can see on the minimap and try to match it up with the map I looked up online. This is probably the most aged aspect of the game. Even with how much I played this game back then, this was a genuine shock to me. So from my hideout I go north into Hepburn Heights, keeping going north into Harwood. I get out of my car and run along the northern edge next to the water. Getting in water will drown you, apparently due to Liberty City's horribly polluted water. I follow this path west to the edge and south a little to drop down and find my first hidden package. Picking these up also gives you a bit of money. I get back in my car and go south, back into Hepburn Heights. I head up the stairs to the train tracks and wait for the train to leave. I run north along the tracks until I can jump off onto the roof of this building. Near the antenna is a second package. I drop from the roof and move east, crossing the road, jumping over a wall and continuing east into St. Mark's. I steal a fire truck and park between the petrol station and this wall. I jump onto the very edge of the wall surrounding the petrol station and walk up to the southeast corner. From there I can drop down and jump across to the roof for my third hidden package. From there I steal a car and go south, take the first left, then cross the road to smash open this window with the fourth hidden package behind it. I also take the Banshee in here and go north, and then take a right and follow the path to something I can't see as I'm writing this because the recording is so dark. I can see the hood, but that's it. I keep driving until I reach Portland Beach and find this house. Then a thunderstorm starts and I really can't see shit. I never got why a thunderstorm turns everything green though. Once it stops, I find hidden package number 5 near the house. I drop down behind the house and keep moving east to reach the end of this cliff overlooking the beach. I fall off the northern side to the sand below and climb up the rocks a little for the sick fitting package. I return to St. Mark's and smash open another shop window for another Banshee. I return to the building in Harwood I found my second package and go west, south, west and south again, and then turn into this site and go around the building to find my seventh hidden package around the back. I use the ramp in this site to jump the wall and go across the wall for the eighth hidden package. I backtrack to the site I found the seventh using this ramp and end up blowing my car up. I steal another and end up squashing a few too many people, getting my first wanted star. One star just means regular foot police will chase after me. I go back to where I found my last package and keep running east to find the ninth in some trees. I keep running east back into St. Mark's and going uphill. I head towards a petrol station, but across the road, I get behind a wall and behind the building there to grab my 10th hidden package. A pistol will now spawn at my hideout alongside the baseball bat. I leave and start going south, back uphill. I turn west a little and check out the remains of these burnt buildings. Near one of the windows is my 11th package. Across the road, I steal a car and move east, going even further uphill. I take the first right turn going west, and turning left again, I find my first rampage. I have 120 seconds and an AK-47 with infinite ammo to kill 20 Mafia members with. Problem is that it takes me 30 of those seconds to find a single one. Once he's shot down, the others all show up and fill me with bullets. I die with only one kill. A death spawns me at the nearest hospital with some of my money taken to pay for the medical bills. My weapons are also confiscated. From the hospital, I return to where I found the rampage and drive a car down this ramp in the back to find some body armour, which is 100 extra health. I return to the highest point uphill in St. Mark's and at the northern side of the street, drive over this ramp and get out when I land to find the 12th hidden package. When I drive over the ramp further down, I get some extra money as a bonus for my insane stunt. I return to Luigi's club and drive through the mission marker so I don't trigger it. Taking the stairs by the back door to the roof gets me my 13th hidden package. I drop down to a lower level of the roof and run along it to get the 14th. From the club I take the first right going north, then take another right to find some stairs up to a roof with the 15th hidden package. Back down the stairs, another rampage. 120 seconds to kill 30 Diablos with an M16. This time it's not a struggle to find any, but it does get me ganged up on and beaten with many baseball bats. And since this is a two-handed gun, I can't sprint to create distance between me and them quickly. In the end, I manage 12 before I get killed. From the hospital, up the ramp and around the corner is a hidden adrenaline pill. It slightly slows down the game movement and time, but in turn gives you a form of super strength. You can knock people fucking flying, it's great. It wears off as soon as I get in the car though. I move west from the hospital into Chinatown, and then north and east back to the red light district. There's another shop window nearby I can smash through for my 16th hidden package. I go back into St. Mark's and drive halfway up this uphill alley. There's a fence I can go through for the 17th package. I then take the chance to relive one of my favourite childhood pastimes, taking a car down this hill for the jump at the bottom. When the family will be taking turns, we just end up taking whatever different cars we'd find down here and seeing how it ends up. Usually with an upside down car soon to explode, but we left our asses off every time. I head back up the hill again and once again go through this gap between the wall and the house to the Portland Beach area. I drop down to the sand once again, take a nearby car and drive directly south to Portland Harbour. Nearby is a tunnel with a circle of homeless people staring at a hidden package. I take it, flattening two of them in the process. That's 18. I also looted their bodies for some Molotov cocktails. I reverse out and up the hill near the entrance into Portland View and take some stairs up to the train tracks. I run east along them for a bit until I can jump off onto another roof that has my 19th hidden package. I jump off the roof and go west back into the streets near the hospital and police station. I head south, west through an alley into Chinatown, then north a little and west again. I keep heading west until I reach the next road and then turn south. I quickly turn east into an alley with the 20th hidden package in it. Now an Uzi will also spawn at my hideout. I lead the way I came and go south, west, south into another alley and up some stairs onto another roof. Hidden package 21 is up here. I then drop down and go east into another alley for the 22nd. I leave and go south, east, south and east again into the Callahan Bridge area. I follow the road and then turn northwest. When I reach the end of this road I take the first right and go through this gate to find the 23rd hidden package. I exit and go north back into Portland View and get back up on the train tracks. I follow them south until I get to Trenton, which is where I just found my last package. I try to jump on a roof but miss, landing next to another rampage. Got 120 seconds to kill 20 triads with a shotgun. I aim my gun once and get shot to death in seconds. Next time I make it back to Trenton, manage to land on the roof I was aiming for and get my 24th hidden package. I go east into Portland Harbour and towards this ship. Close to it is some stairs that get me up on the roof of one of the warehouses. I jump across to another roof that has the 25th hidden package. That's a quarter of them. Of course the remaining 75 aren't all in Portland, so you'll get a break from these packages soon. I leave and go back into Trenton. Near the location I found the 23rd package, there's a side alley that takes me to the 26th hidden package. And right nearby is another rampage. Will I actually finish this one? No. I have 120 seconds to destroy 13 vehicles with a rocket launcher. It starts off well when the first vehicle I destroy blows up in my face and gets everyone running up to punch me. And then the second one also brings me down to 26 health. The next one I blow up comes towards me in a fireball and finishes me off. Once again I head down to Trenton and across the road from the 23rd package and to the left a little, I ram through this fence my 27th package. Also, a police car tipped itself over chasing me and blew itself up, but because it was self-inflicted, it doesn't raise my wanted level. I head west to reach the still heavily damaged Callahan Bridge. I jump onto the southern wall and use it to jump higher and get behind this sign for my 28th package. I backtrack the way I came a little to try and jump onto this roof using a ramp. First two attempts gets my car blown up, but a new one passes by so I can easily try again. I get a better run up, but this time I end up going over the roof. I barely make it next time and can drop down behind this wall surrounding the entire area. In here I can run up into another roof and cross several more to find my 29th hidden package. From here I drop down and head west into Callahan Point. Following the road west brings me back around to Chinatown. I steal a triad fish van and go south, using a different road back into Callahan Point, then south down the side path into the site of said triad fish business. I need the van to open the gate so I can get in, run over all the triads so they can't gun me down when I get out, and pick up the 30th hidden package in here. Grenades are now spawning at my hideout this time. I head east from here to Atlantic Keys. I reach the southern edge of the island and at the end of this pier, grab my 31st hidden package. That's all the hidden packages I can get right now until I have access to areas outside Portland. But we're far from continuing the story just yet. There's a side quest to be done in Portland Harbour, the Import-Export. There's a storage unit with a load of names on a sign next to it. These are all the names of cars that can be found in Liberty City. I have to bring one of every car they're asking for, of which there are 16. Turns out the perennial I drove here in isn't one that they're wanting. In the harbour there is a mule, which is one of the vehicles they want. So I just take it over, leave it in the unit and it gets crossed off the list. I get paid with the promise of the bonus for completing the list. I leave the harbour and outside I see a Yankee. I appreciate two of the lorries they want being so close to where I have to drop them off so I don't have to deal with their crappy handling as much. That's delivered. To the west of the harbour I find a coach. These longer vehicles are ridiculously unwieldy, but this is the only time I need a coach. That's 3 out of 16. In one of the far corners of the harbour is this line runner. I drop it off and in less than 8 minutes, that's a quarter of the list completed. During this I got my wanted level up to 2. This mainly just increases the volume of the police chasing me a bit. More cars after me. They're also more willing to just shoot me rather than knock me down and arrest me. In Portland View, in the car park of this supermarket, I get in a Patriot. Now this kicks off an optional mission, but I'll do that later. Instead I take it to the storage unit, but it won't open thanks to the police hanging around me. I have to get some distance between me and the police before I can drop it off. I decide to fight off the police, which gets my wanted level increased to 3, which is when helicopters with snipers come after me. I realise there's no way out and throw grenades around which increases the level to 4, which gets SWAT teams after me as well. In the end I'm gunned down, but I'm only down the street from the hospital so it's not really an inconvenience. Close to the harbour I steal a pony van and hand it over to be exported. The next van I take is the Rumpo, found in Trenton. 7 out of 16. In St. Mark's I take the Bobcat across the road from the petrol station. That's half of the list complete. In Harwood I find a Moonbeam van and drop that one off too. At this point I decide to check out how much of the game is done and see those packages have helped me get up to 8%. That's where I leave it for now, as some of the remaining cars require some extra steps. In Hepburn Heights, there's a van parked next to a building that begins Diablo Destruction, an optional mission, if I get inside. I have 2 minutes to destroy as many Diablo gang cars as I can using this bomb-rigged RC car. The cars I'm after are black with a flame pattern. Just driving into the wheels is enough to blow them up. For a toy, this car moves pretty fast. In those 2 minutes I destroy 4 cars, making a new record and passing the mission. Halfway down a hill in St. Mark's is a car that starts another RC car mission when I get in, Mafia Massacre. I just have to destroy Mafia cars this time. Their cars are just plain black. I do a bit better in this one, taking out 6 cars in my 2 minutes. Next up, I move on to the taxi mission. Stealing a taxi and pressing R3 starts a side mission where I pick up a passenger marked on the map and take them to their destination. Each step I complete adds to the timer and I have until time runs out. It's an alright side mission, but it does kind of make me wish I was just playing Crazy Taxi instead. I'm skipping about an hour or so of footage because it's just the same stuff repeated. Once you've finished a combined 100 fares, you unlock the Borg 9 taxi. It's a modified taxi that can now be found in Harwood. It's a cabbie, but improved in every way. This drove me and my brother mad as kids. We were fascinated by this unlockable taxi we had to do so much to unlock. But for whatever reason, our game would always freeze on the message saying we unlocked it. So this year is the first time I ever got to see it and try it out. But around the corner is my next side mission. I steal this fire truck and press R3 to begin the firefighter mission. There's cars on fire around and I have to get there in time and use the orders to put them out. Very simple. The fire truck can be a little hard to control, but it can get surprisingly fast for a large vehicle in this game. This side mission is also important for spawning some more cars I need for the import-export. One car this side mission spawns for me is the Trashmaster. I take it to the storage unit and that's just 6 cars left. 10 minutes later, this mission gives me a blister I needed. 5 left. A few more minutes later, the mission spawns me a Mr. Whoopi. 4 left now. Thanks to a misunderstanding, I end up extinguishing 48 fires instead of the 20 I needed. I thought I needed to do 20 fires to unlock a flamethrower for that island's hideout only. Actually, I have to do 20 on each of the game's islands first, which puts a flamethrower on every hideout at once. So I wasted a lot of time. But it's time for the next side mission, Vigilante. I steal a police car and press R3 to activate it. I have to chase down escaping criminal cars and deal with them during the time limit. The easiest way to do this is to get the target vehicle on screen and then pause the game. For some reason, after I unpause, they stop the car and get out, letting me easily run them over instead of destroying my car and failing the mission trying to take them out. I don't know why this works, but it makes things so much easier. Shame the same trick doesn't make the real police leave me alone. Getting 10 kills in Portland adds a police bribe item to my hideout. These can be found elsewhere in the game. Picking one up removes one of your wanted stars. A combined 20 kills in Portland adds a second police bribe to my hideout. This was much easier than I was expecting, for both this and Firefighter. Last time I did these was in Vice City, where to get the rewards I had to do all the required tasks in one long session without failing. I still have flashbacks to delivering my final patient to get the reward and my ambulance catching a rogue grain of sand that sent it flying upside down and making me repeat the entire thing. Speaking of the paramedic mission, we're not doing that yet, I was putting it off. Next is the unique jump stunts. There's 20 of these in the game. Certain spots that I can ramp with my car count as unique jumps, and these are also required for my 100%. The jump isn't the only part of the stunt, however. Getting the landing right is also required. Thing is, there isn't that much to actually say about most of them, so here's a compilation of the 8 in Portland with little commentary overall, plus some failed attempts. Fuck you. This particular failure was a blessing in disguise as I happened to get knocked in front of a rare security car, which I steal and drop off at the import-export. That was half an hour for one jump. I still have 7 left. This particular one on Callahan Bridge was a nightmare. You have to land perfectly, with all 4 wheels touching the ground on the exact same microsecond. After one failed attempt, while looking for a new car, I find the flatbed, another car I need for the import-export, just 2 left. Sadly, it seems I missed or accidentally deleted the recording of that jump. Each jump's reward increases by $50,000, but the next jump I have recorded gives me 20 grand instead of 15 grand. And that's all 8 jumps in Portland. Next is paramedic. I kill a pedestrian and wait for an ambulance to appear so I can steal it. I have to drive to the patient marked by a blip, expect this injured person to be able to get in the ambulance themselves, and get them to the hospital in time. What makes this hard is that the ambulance is a piece of shit that flips over at the slightest turns. Deliver one patient and I reach level 2, which has 2 patients. This first attempt ends here as I run out of time. As the levels go up, so do the amount of patients. This one ends at level 4, thanks to accidentally pinning the patient under my ambulance and stopping them from getting up. Picking up a patient gives you more time, but dropping them off doesn't unless it starts the next level. My next attempt fails at level 6 when my flimsy ambulance catches fire and explodes. This is one side mission where I have to clear the objective for the final reward in one go. But there are some others unlocked for non-consecutive play. A total of 43 patients saved sends a health restore pickup to my hideout, and saving a total of 78 patients delivers an adrenaline pill to my hideout. It takes me a couple hours, but I manage to save all 78 patients in one go across 12 levels. This gives me an upgrade to my sprint. Before it would last a few seconds before Claude got tired, but now he never runs out of breath and can sprint forever. Remember that Patriot that kicked off a side mission I didn't do? Time for that. I go back to that supermarket and get in to start Patriot Playground. In this car I have 5 minutes to drive through 15 checkpoints. Most of these are across the beach. The timer starts when I pass through the first checkpoint, giving me 20 seconds per checkpoint. 5 minutes to 15 sounds very generous, but even 20 seconds can be not enough for a single checkpoint with how many steep hills I have to force the car up. Many times it would end with the car tipping backwards and landing upside down, failing the mission. It takes me many attempts across 45 minutes before I just get all the angles going uphill right and all the locations of the checkpoints memorized before I finally get all 15 in one go and finish the mission. Of course, my victory is followed by crashing into the sea and drowning seconds later. And now the last thing to do before I continue the story is the rampages. Once again, there isn't much to say, so I'll just show you me completing them. I'll speed them all up so it goes by quicker. No fail attempts this time, there's none interesting to show. And that's 6 out of the game's 20 rampages done. Without forwarding the story once, I've got myself up to 22%. Well, it's finally time to go to Luigi for that promised work, but look at my money. I have 716 grand, do I really need the work? The first mission Luigi has for me is called Don't Spank My Bitch Up. Luigi doesn't meet me, instead he's left a note for me. It says there's a new drug being sold on the streets named Spank, and someone has been giving it to his girls in Portland Harbour. I have to deal with him, take his car, and get it resprayed. So being the first proper mission, this is simple. I drive down to Portland Harbour, gun the guy down and take his stallion and drive it to the pay and spray. This not only repairs your car and changes its colour, It also removes any wanted stars you've built up as the police no longer recognise the car. The last step is driving the car to Luigi's lockup across the road from the hospital and parking it in the garage. Mission passed. Next mission from Luigi is drive Misty for me. This time Luigi is here to talk to me. He wants me to drive Misty from the tutorial mission to Joey Leone, the Don's son. Joey is a regular of Misty. She's in Hepburn Heights, which is the territory of the Diablos who aren't on good terms with the Mafia. Joey himself is at his garage in Trenton. This is another simple one. I drive up to Hepburn Heights, get in a blue marker and beep for Misty. She leaves the building and gets in my car. After that, the drive to Joey's in Trenton goes without incident. Except for a few people I flatten on the way there. I drop Misty off and get to meet Joey. Luigi put in a good word for us, so Joey also has some jobs for me. With that mission done, Joey's missions are now available, marked with the J on the minimap. But I want to deal with all of Luigi's missions first. His next mission is Pump Action Pimp. Luigi's pretty pissed because the Diablo has been pimping on his turf and I have to put a stop to it. He tells me where I can find a gun, but thanks to all the hidden packages, I'm plenty prepared. The guy can be found driving around Hepburn Heights. I ram into his car, making him and a partner get out to shoot. I get out with my Uzi and get killed in no time. Next time I pull them over again, only for one to drag me out of my car. I just get back in and ram the shit out of them to pass the mission. I get paged to tell me I can now buy a pistol and ammunition, marked on the map as a gun. But I can get that for free from my hideout, so it's not a big deal. The final mission I get from Luigi is the Fuzzball. A policeman's ball is being held at a school near Callahan Bridge. Luigi wants me to pick up some of his girls already on the street and get as many of them as I can there to get as much money from the police as they can. I have 5 minutes to get at least 4 of them there. It's not complicated, the girls are marked on the map and I can have 3 in my car at a time. I drop those 3 off at the school hall and go pick up more. Despite only needing 4 at minimum, I get all 8 of them there for an extra $2,000 on top of the normal reward. And that's all missions for Luigi complete. You may think Joey would be next, but not just yet. Across the road to the right of Joey's garage is a ringing payphone. Walking up to it starts the crook. The caller is Marty Chunks. He runs a dog food factory behind that wall next to me. He's meeting his bank manager who keeps screwing him by constantly upping his loan repayments. I have to take Marty's car to pick him up and bring him back here. I get the car and pick the manager up just outside Chinatown. I bring him back, we hear a struggle and a strange squishy sound, so I don't know if he was stabbed or fed into the machinery and turned into dog food. I mean, he is being made into dog food regardless, I don't know if that's what killed him first. I have to get the car crushed to dispose of the evidence. The crusher is in hardwood and right in front of it, I fail the mission by flipping the car and blowing it up. Thing is, the payphone only rings at certain times of day, so I'm just stuck out here standing in front of it and waiting so I can try again. I get the car there next time and stick it under the crane to get it crushed and complete the mission. I head back to the phone to start the thieves. Marty hired some thieves to break into his house and steal things so he can claim insurance. But they're turning around on him and threatening to tell the insurance company if he doesn't give them a cut. He has another car for me to pick them up in and bring them back to work out the deal. Marty says they're in the red light district, but they're actually in Chinatown. I pick them up and bring them back. Like the bank manager, they become dog food. I just have to get the car resprayed this time. Once that's done, I just drop it back off at the factory to finish the mission. I run right back to the phone to start the wife. Marty's business will fail if he doesn't get some more money soon. His wife has an insurance policy and he's spending his money, so of course he wants me to bring her back here. I take his car again and pick her up from Classic Nails in the red light district. I take her back where she is dog food like the rest. To get rid of the evidence this time, I have to dump the car into the sea. I reverse up to the edge and get out just as the back wheels leave the ground. Mission passed. Another long wait for the phone to start ringing. When it does, I start his final mission, her lover. Turns out Marty's dead wife was cheating on him with someone he owes money to, and that guy isn't happy. As usual, he wants me to bring him here under the idea Marty's going to pay him, but the actual intention is to make more dog food. I take Marty's car and pick the guy up in Chinatown. I drive him back and Marty actually comes outside to talk with the guy, called Carl. Marty invites him inside but it doesn't work and Carl blows him away with a shotgun. I guess Carl paid me for this mission's completion. Carl takes over the business but doesn't seem to know how to open the door. Since this is the only point in the game I can see him, I kill him. Be rude not to. Now for Joey's missions. I go across the road to his garage and start My Clip's Last Lunch, which starts with probably the most remembered line in the game.
Hey, I'm bored, when are you gonna drill me?
The Ferrelli brothers have owed money to Joey for a long time. Libs Ferrelli is eating at the St. Mark's Bistro, so I have to steal his car and get it rigged with a bomb. I have 6 minutes to get this done. I go up into St. Mark's to steal the car, but on the way to 8 Ball to get the bomb put in, I flip the car and it explodes, failing the mission. I get the car there next time when 8 Ball installs the bomb. I park it in the spot I stole it from and arm the bomb before I get out. Once Libs is done eating, he gets in the car, turns on the engine and gets blown to fuck. Mission passed. I return to Joey for my next mission, Farewell Chunky Lee Chong. Lee Chong is dealing spank for a new gang from Colombia. He has noodle stand in Chinatown and I have to take him out. He warns me that Chinatown is Triad territory, so I go over there and approach Lee, who runs away as the Triads try to kill me. But I gun him down first. Easy. Next mission is Van Heist. My target is the payroll van that leaves the edges of Chinatown every day. It's heavily armoured, so I have to ram it off the road until the security guards get scared off. After that, I have to take it to a warehouse at the docks. I take my car into Chinatown and start ramming the shit out of that van. I almost fill up his damage bar, but my car catches fire, and when I get out to run away, another car comes up from behind and pins me in, getting killed in the explosion. Next time I fill the bar and make the drivers flee, but I also built up 2 wanted stars. So as soon as I get in the van myself, the police open my door behind me and bust me. Third try, I finally get hold of that van. I drive it to Portland Harbour and put it in the garage to pass the mission. I get a message on my pager saying El Burro has a job for me from the payphone in Hepburn Heights. So I decide to take a break from Joey to see what this is about. I go up to the payphone to start Turismo. El Burro is from the Diablos. He says that Claude is beginning to gain a reputation in Liberty City. There's a street race starting by the school hall from Luigi's mission near Callahan Bridge. First draw the checkpoint wins. I take the Borgnine taxi down there. There's 3 of us to race against and it doesn't start well when I fuck up trying for a shortcut and end up with a smoking car and the others nowhere in sight. And I get the police on me when I reach Chinatown. After a while, I finally catch up to 2nd place only for another car to smack me into a wall. I'm in luck when 2nd place gets stuck against a lamppost and I take 2nd, but I lose soon after. Things go a lot better next time. I end up in 2nd from the start to about halfway through where I finally take 1st. I keep that place till I cross the last checkpoint and win, passing the mission. I return to the payphone for El Burro's 2nd mission, I Scream, You Scream. El Burro runs an exotic entertainment business and rival gangers threaten to kill his starring cast member if he doesn't pay them. They love ice cream though, and he's hidden the bomb in Harwood. I have to hijack an ice cream van and take it to their warehouse in Atlantic Key to blow them up. Step 1, grab the briefcase with the bomb inside. Step 2, take the ice cream van in St. Mark's. Step 3, drive to Atlantic Key and park with the jingle playing. Boom, mission passed. Now back to Joey for Cipriani's chauffeur. Joey introduces Claude to Tony Cipriani. I have to drive him to his mother's restaurant in St. Mark's. Before I go, Joey tells me he has another job for me later. Tony has a few extra stops for me to take him first. First, he wants me to drive him to the laundromat in Chinatown. The workers there haven't been paying him protection money. I also can't mess up the car too much, since Joey just fixed it up. I take him where he wants and wait while he goes inside with a bat ready to smash it up. Instead, he gets shot at and chased out to the car. We've been ambushed by Triads, so I escape and take him to the restaurant. Tony isn't happy with the Triads taking him on and asks me to come by later to get back at them. The mission is complete and I can now do missions for Tony, marked by the T on the map. But I want to finish Joey's first. I also get told I can buy the Uzi at Ammunition, the same Uzi I've had free at the hideout for ages now. Next Joey mission is Dead Skunk in the Trunk. There's a car parked at the cafe near Callahan Point with a corpse in the boot. It's yet another one of the Farrelly brothers. Seems the 15 years since Vice City and Tommy killing Sonny haven't been very kind to them. He wants the body crushed, so I go over there and get in the car, only for more Farrelly brothers to try chasing me down. I make it to Harwood where the Crusher is, but take too much damage and the car explodes, killing me as well. Second time, I ram into the Farrelly's car first before getting in the car with the body. The plan is to blow up their cars, but mine catches fire first and I get pinned between it and one of theirs and can't escape the explosion. Third time, I picked up the grenades at my hideout and blew them up that way. With nothing else in my way, I still fail when I flip the car. Fourth time, I blow up the Farrellys again, but in their last moments they rush me and take me with them. Fifth time, I jump myself onto the cafe roof and blow them up from above so they can't try that again. Or try to, I keep missing. I catch myself in an explosion before I get any of them. Instead, I blow up the car I needed to take. Sixth try, I use them to death and finally get that car and the body to the Crusher. Normally a simple mission, I made things much more complicated than it needed to be. Joey's next mission is the Getaway. I need to get a car to a safe house in St. Mark's to pick up some of Joey's friends. They're gonna rob a bank and need me as a driver. The bank closes at 5 p.m. and I start this mission at 6:30, so I have plenty of time. I get to the safe house and beep everyone out. I get them to the bank in Chinatown and they go in and get out with the money. This puts the wanted level straight to 3 while I escape back to the safe house. As the end is in sight, my van catches fire as a police car flies over me and we all go up in flames. I manage it next time, but I still need to get rid of the police. So I drive to my hideout and use the bribes there. But a police car rams me the microsecond after I get rid of the wanted stars and puts another back on. I shake them off again and finally drop the guys back off at the safe house. And that's all of Joey's missions complete, now for Tony. The first mission he has for me is taking out the laundry. It's time for Tony's revenge on the laundromat and the Triads. His little rant also sets off Tony's never seen only her domineering mother who he's terrified of. As a kid I thought this guy was like 60, but he's supposed to be in his 30s. aged really badly in the 3 years between Liberty City Stories and this game. Tony wants me to destroy their vans and kill any of them who get in their way. He says 8-Ball has what I need. But I ignore that advice and just drive alongside them, filling them with Uzi fire. The first one takes a bit of a chase to bring down, but the second makes the fatal error of stopping at a traffic light and giving me the perfect chance. Then the third one takes another chase and gets destroyed in about the same place as the first, finishing this mission. Next from Tony is the pickup. Tony isn't in, so his mother tells me he left a note. The laundromat has finally agreed to pay the protection money, so he wants me to go pick it up and bring it back. Also, when I first met Tony, his surname was pronounced with a soft C, but in this cutscene it's Cipriani with a hard C. That's weird. I drive down to Chinatown and pick up the money behind the shop, only for some triads to show up and start shooting at me. I have to kill all of them to proceed. It gets very close, but I just manage it when the last one gets stuck behind a van I can just blow up. I then get back to Tony's to pass the mission. Since I'm already there, I can start a Salvatore's Call to Meeting right away. Tony's still out. The note says that Salvatore Leone, the Don and Joey's dad, has called a meeting. I have to get a limo and pick up Joey, Luigi and then Tony himself to take them there. First it's down to Trenton to get the limo and pick up Joey. Then it's to the red light district for Luigi, and then back to St. Mark's for Tony. As soon as he gets in the car, a triad van shows up and opens fire on me. I head towards Salvatore's to the east of St. Mark's, but their vans are blocking the path there. As I look around for another way there, two more vans just pile on top of me. The limo takes too much punishment and we all burn up in the explosion. Next time I just brute force between the two vans blocking my path, and as I inch towards Salvatore's home, I fall off the cliff and the car gets destroyed again. I make it there next time and park in the garage. I get introduced to Salvatore, who after being all huggy with the others, says he sees good things for Claude. That's the mission passed, and Salvatore, marked with an S, also has some missions for me. Also, say goodbye to Luigi and Joey, that's the last we'll be seeing them. There's another mission from El Burro available, so I head back to Hepburn Heights to answer that phone for Trial by Fire. Triad stole his car the night before and destroyed it, taking out his precious donkey memorabilia in the boot as well. He's hidden the weapon on the edge of Chinatown for me to get his revenge with. Said weapon, hidden in an alley, is the flamethrower. This mission is kind of like a rampage. I have 2.5 minutes to kill 25 triads and I have unlimited ammo. The flamethrower is fun. Normally the triads would try shooting me or beating me with bats, but with this they daren't come near me. There's also the chance when they run wild on fire that they spread their fire to someone else. However, I run out of time with only 2 triads left to kill. On my second try, I end up lighting myself on fire and giving the police a chance to bust me. Third time, I run out of time with 3 left. But on my 4th try, I get all 25 and pass the mission. I return to the payphone for Big and Vainy. Someone high on Spank has stolen the van with El Burro's latest publication. But they've left the rear doors open, spilling all the porn all over the streets. I have to get to the van by following the trail of porn, collecting it on the way. A van has been left for me outside to store it all. I start with 25 seconds and every stack I pick up adds a second back. At one point I end up on a long stretch alternating between 0 and 1 second. In the end, other cars in the way fails me the mission. I get further next time, all the way to Callahan Point, but bumping into a traffic light ends that attempt. Third time I get lost and run out of the clock. Fourth time a selfish dickhead packs right over the pawn and stops me picking it up. My fifth and successful attempt has me follow the trail all the way to Portland Harbour. Once I've got it all, I take the van to the back of the pawn shop in the red light district and hand it over, passing the mission and completing all my business with El Burro. All that's available right now is the first mission from Salvatore, Chaperone. While he deals with his business, I have to look after his too young for him wife, Maria Latore, who he also talks to like shit. I basically have to take her wherever she wants. This is the scene where she called Claude Fido, and since Claude's name wouldn't be revealed for another 3 years when he appears as an NPC in San Andreas, many people thought it was his actual name, not getting that she was calling him a dog's name as an insult. Although speaking of that, back in my primary school, since we were all 9 years old playing this game when it came out, a lot of kids thought his name was Max, based on the shortening of maximum in the stats. So they thought it would be saying Max's insane jump height instead of maximum insane jump height. So I get the limo to drive Maria around in. My first destination is meeting this Chico guy in the edge of Chinatown. He offers her this spank we keep hearing about, but instead she just wants her usual drugs. He tells Maria there's a party at the warehouse at Atlantic Keys. That's my next destination. I have to wait in the car while she goes inside to party. However, the party's about to get rear by the police while she's in there. Maria gets back in the car and I have to get her back to Salvatore's, which I do. It's nice to finish the mission on the first try again. Maria ends up being quite fond of Claude. She enjoyed herself and he treated her with respect. I mean, he doesn't talk, which is probably a huge improvement over Salvatore by default. With that mission done, another mission is available from Tony, so I do that first. It's called Triads and Tribulations. Once again, he isn't in, so he left a note. The Triads are using a fish factory as a front and most of their business is done in the Chinatown fish market. The laundromats still aren't paying their protection, so we're pretty much taking all their leads down at once. I have two guys as backup following me. First is the fish market where I blow the guy away with a shotgun. I get in the car and move on, abandoning my mafia help. Next leader is across the street from the laundromat, who I drive by with an Uzi and quickly mow down. Then it's the same factory at Callahan Point I found a hidden package, but I still need the fish van to get through the gate. Instead, I just run around the back throwing grenades over the wall until I blow him up. It takes quite a few tries and in the end I have to press a grenade against the wall and let the explosion hitbox pass through to kill him and finish the mission. I go back to Tony to start Blow Fish. He's actually here to meet me this time. He's ready to finish off the triads in Liberty City for good. 8-Ball rigged the dusk out with a bomb. He tells me to pick it up and that it's very sensitive, so the slightest bump could trigger it. I have to drive through the gates of the fish factory with it and park between the gas canisters. I pick it up in the northeastern corner of St. Mark's and have 2.5 minutes to get it down to Callahan Point. I get a bit worried when the damage bar nearly fills about 2/3 of the way there, but I reach the factory with 30 seconds left. I reach the blue mark to park it, and a tiny bump is the final hit needed to make the car explode and take me with it. Next time I get there with no damage at all and park it where Tony told me. I activate the bomb and belt it out of there while the triad shoot at me. The factory is wiped out in the explosion and that's all of Tony's missions complete. All that's left right now is to continue Salvatore's. Cutting the grass is his next mission. A Colombian cartel are making spank and seem to know the mafia's every move, so Salvatore believes there's a rat. A guy called Curly Bob works at Luigi's bar, spending more than he's earning, so Salvatore thinks he could be making it from leaking. I have to follow his taxi home after his shift and if he is talking, I kill him. I drive down to Luigi's and hang out by his taxi, waiting for Bob to get in. Then I fuck up immediately by bumping into said taxi and scaring him off. Second time I park way too close to his taxi and fail as soon as he gets in. How was I supposed to know blocking his exit from work with my car might be seen as suspicious? Still too close next time. He even gets confused against my car and phases on top at one point. Fourth attempt I finally do it right. I hang back and follow trying not to fill up Bob's spookometer. I follow him all the way down to Portland Harbour and watch him get out. It turns out he's been talking to Catalina, Claude's ex-girlfriend who betrayed him at the start of the game. The co-leader of the cartel, Miguel, is here too. Bob has in fact been talking in exchange for spank. One important detail is that the turf war with the Triads and Joey's feud with the Thorellis is losing the Mafia their influence in Liberty City. The result is that Salvatore is becoming increasingly paranoid and isn't trusting anybody. Once Catalina and Miguel leave, I drive around the corner and right through Bob, finishing the mission. I return to Salvatore for his third mission, Bomb Da Base Act 1. The cartel has too much money from selling spank to take them on directly. Salvatore reasons they must be making it on the boat Curly Bob led me to. He wants me to destroy it. If I do this for him, I'll be able to get anything I want from him. This puts 8-Ball on the map, marked with an 8. Going over there starts Bomb Da Base Act 2. This is a big job, so he needs 100 grand to fund it. Good thing for me, I recently became a millionaire. He has the explosives, but his hands are still injured so he can't use a gun. He gives me a sniper rifle to use when we get there. He gets in the van with me and I drive him down to Portland Harbour. 8-Ball tells me to find a good spot and he'll go in there with the bomb as I fire my first shot. I climb up the stairs onto the roof of this warehouse and take aim. I plan badly with the first three I kill. They aren't the nearest ones to 8-Ball, so he just runs right up to the first guy by the boat and gets killed. Next time, I take an adrenaline pill nearby to slow everyone down and actually start by taking out the two guards by the ramp onto the boat so 8-Ball doesn't die right away. My sniper reticle isn't slowed down, so it makes things much easier for me. But 8-Ball still gets himself killed somehow. My third attempt goes much smoother and I don't even use the adrenaline. 8-Ball runs inside and we soon see him outrunning the boat's explosion. That's the cartel spank factory beneath the sea, and the mission passed. I return to Salvatore to start Last Requests. He's very happy with my performance and has just one more job for me. There's a car parked behind Luigi's club filled with the remains of a recent mafia victim. He wants me to get it crushed before the police find it. Sounds very simple. I get close to the car but get paged by Maria. She saves the car at a trap and to meet her at the slip south of Callahan Bridge. So I drive down there. Salvatore thinks Claude has been sleeping with Maria behind his back and was going to offer him to the cartel to make a deal. Why does he think that? Is it just because he's naturally paranoid? Nah, Maria straight up told him that was going on. I mean, Salvatore's a massive arsehole, but Maria got me marked by the Mafia for no reason. So we have to get out of Portland. An old friend of hers, Asuka Kasson, shows up to help us. Everyone gets on a boat and I now have to drive across to Staunton Island, the second of the game's three islands. Maria tells me to just go look around while she and Asuka talk. Asuka tells me of the warehouse at the edge of Belleville that will act as my new hideout. When I'm ready, I have to go back to her to sort things out. She's on the map here in Newport with an A. But first, new island, new side stuff to get done. I run over to my new hideout to save. All bonuses from side missions and hidden packages carried over to this one too. But before exploring Staunton Island, I have a little cleanup to do in Portland, so I get on the boat and drive back. There's these rocks around the south of the island that contain the 32nd hidden package. The subway in the red light district is now open, so I can go down there and grab the 33rd hidden package. I then get on the train and take it back to Staunton Island. Now for Staunton's hidden packages. From my hideout I drive north, all the way to Rockford at the far north end. Behind one of the buildings here is the 34th hidden package. I go south and a little west into Espatria where the stadium is. Behind one of the signs there is the 35th hidden package. I go south into Rockford and east into the hospital car park and park in this spot in the northwestern corner. I jump on top of the ambulance and enter this roof for the 36th hidden package. I leave the way I entered, go south until I take the first right and then go up the stadium steps. In one of the gated off entrances is the 37th package. I go back down the steps and go back east into Liberty Campus. On the opposite end of the site to where I entered is hidden package number 38. I go up the hill behind me and move east into Fort Staunton and ram a car through the fence to get into the construction site. In the southeastern part of this site, I climb up the unfinished building and on the second floor is my 39th package. I leave the site and end up with people shooting at me. So I run east a little, not noticing the huge drop into the sea where I drown. After I reload, I drive over to the bridge on the far east of Fort Staunton. I run up the frame on the side and go up top. I run across the middle for my 40th hidden package. The shotgun will now spawn in my hideouts. North of my hideout, I return to Espatria and hijack a bus. I go south through the bridge I got my last package and into Newport. I go south across another bridge and then west into Belleville Park. Then another east which takes me back to Callaghan Bridge, which is now fixed. I return to Portland Harbour and drop the bus off at the import-export. Just one vehicle is missing from their list now. I steal a cartel cruiser and return to the street I stole the bus. There's this gate that only opens when I'm in a cruiser. In this little area is my 41st hidden package. I turn to the construction site in Fort Staunton and in the southeastern corner is the 42nd package. I go south from the site back into Newport and then turn right into another alley to find the 43rd package. I move west a little from there and into this multi-story car park. On the second level, hidden in the corner, is package 44. I go north a little and all the way west towards Belleville Park. I turn into the alley on the left at the end to find my 45th hidden package. Then it's east and south a little until I can cut through the grass west onto this bridge. I follow it up and around halfway so I can jump off the northeast edge and land on a roof with another hidden package. That's 46. I run back across the grass to the bridge I was just on and this time drop off the west side to the bridge below. This lets me search under the bridge I dropped from to find the 47th hidden package. I backtrack east and jump into the park that Belleville Park is named for. I get my 48th package in one of the basketball courts. Further south in the park, I can find another package, 49. I exit the park to the east and keep moving that way into Newport. I continue running east and end up around the edge of the island. I try to jump down to the dock by Asuka's mission marker, but barely fail to make it and drown. Next time I just use the stairs like a reasonable person. And it was the wrong dock, I was wanting the one just south of it. At the end is my 50th hidden package, unlocking body armour at my hideout. That's half of them. I return to Callaghan Bridge but turn south instead of getting on. I take the first left and follow the path to the end for the 51st hidden package. I return to the road and take the next left and go up the steps of what I assume is Liberty City Hall for my 52nd hidden package. I drop down on the south and then move east, dropping down to some more docks. Or I would if I didn't miss it by inches. At this camera angle, Claude looks like he's been dragged into another dimension. I get down there without dying next time and pick up my 53rd hidden package. At this point in the game, I'm at 42% completion. I go further south from the City Hall than last time, taking me into Torrington. A little to the left, I can pick up hidden package number 54. Then a little further south and to the right is a tunnel that takes me into the police station car park. I take a police car and use it to get through this gate, leading me to my 55th hidden package. I head to the westernmost road on the island in Bedford Point. Going south, I take a left in between all these buildings to find my 56th hidden package next to a church. Then I run south, take the first left and left again into an alley with the 57th package. I then go east some more into Torrington and downstairs into this underground car park to find the 58th hidden package. Once I leave, I run around this building to find a series of stairs leading up to the 59th package. I drop off the building and run directly west, back into Bedford Point and against this window that I break with a shotgun. I go inside and up the stairs to my 60th hidden package. I can now grab Molotov cocktails for free at my hideout. When I leave, I head south and then west until I can turn left into another alley containing hidden package 61. I leave the alley through the southeast exit and move south to the end of the street and follow it around west and then east of the next turn to find my 62nd hidden package. I keep moving east along this street until I can turn right again and go up these stairs and jump onto a roof to find the 63rd hidden package. I return to that street and go west of the edge of the island. There's a pier, and near it, the 64th hidden package. I go back to the stairs that led me to the 63rd package, and next to it is a ramp going underground. In here is my 65th hidden package. When I exit, it's east again, south to the end of the street, east some more until I can go up these steps onto an arch and grab my 66th package. I keep moving east a little more until I see this sculpture. The 67th hidden package is behind it. That's over two-thirds collected. I go east some more and then north to reach this casino. There's some stairs near the entrance that take me to the roof where the 68th hidden package is hiding behind a helicopter. That's the final hidden package of Staunton Island. Now for side missions. Slightly north of Callahan Bridge is a van that when I get inside starts the optional mission Casino Calamity. It's another RC car mission. 2 minutes to blow up as many Yakuza cars as possible. I manage 5 and pass the mission. Next is putting out 20 fires in the firefighter mission again. There's nothing else to say about this, it takes me about 18 minutes to do all 20. No reward yet, got one more island to do it on later. Next is doing Vigilante again. Once again the pause trick is used a lot to make things go smoother. With 20 more criminal kills, I now have an extra 2 police bribes at my hideout for a total of 4. Now for the insane jump stunts. Portland had 8, but Staunton Island only has 4. Near the basketball court in Belleville Park is a car that when entered starts the optional mission, A Ride in the Park. It's another off-road challenge driving through checkpoints like Patriot Playground. This time I have 2 minutes for 12 checkpoints. But the fact that I'm driving this bulky Landstalker and there's a million trees around to block me makes it so much harder. And of course there's the usual steep hill problems too. This one wasn't as bad as Patriot Playground though, and it only takes me 15 minutes to complete instead of 40 something. Then I return to that multi-story car park. I take a stallion out to the entrance and get back inside to start multi-story mayhem. 2 minutes for 20 checkpoints across the car park. I fail the first time but get it the second. The tricky part is the final checkpoint being in the air requiring you ramp it. With those two done, the last step before continuing the story is Staunton Island's rampages. And with all that out of the way, I think I've explored the city enough, so let's get back to Asuka. Her first mission is Sayonara Salvatore. She says some things need to be cleared up before she can work with me. She is Yakuza, and I must first prove that my ties with the Mafia are broken. Salvatore will be leaving Luigi's at 8:30 and I have to kill him before he gets to his own club. Meanwhile, her and Maria will be catching up. I drive down to the red light district and wait outside Luigi's. Salvatore leaves at 8:30 and I think to try running him over. Instead, I get spotted and my car gets so embarrassed it self-destructs. Next time I get gunned down by his men, giving him the chance to escape. Next time I do something smart. Instead of causing a scene, I hang back with a sniper rifle and shoot him in the head. With the mission passed and Salvatore dead, the Mafia hate me for the rest of the game. So if I ever go around St. Mark's from now on, they'll all aggro me and fill me with bullets. As I return to Staunton Island, I get paged, saying a King Courtney would like to speak with me. I can do this at the payphone in Aspatria. I return to Asuka for my next mission, Under Surveillance. She's very happy with Salvatore's death and introduces Claude to her brother, Kenji. He tells me that once I'm done with Asuka's job, to drop by his casino for more work. A source in the police says that the Mafia is keeping an eye on the Yakuza to track Claude down. Since that's inhibiting their business, I have to take out these spies. There's 4 markers on the map and I have 6.5 minutes to deal with them all. Good thing for me, a Banshee, one of the fastest cars in the game, is parked next to where I start. The first two are in Belleville Park. My attempt at running them over doesn't work and my car flips, but they do get caught in the resulting explosion. Next one is in a van parked in Bedford Point. I ram it until they get out, but my shotgun also blows up my own van and kills me too. Next time I just ooze the van until it explodes. The last lot are across the road from Kenji's casino. I have to get on the roof but find none of my guns reach them and I don't have a sniper. So I rush down to ammunition to buy one and rush back to take down all 6 or so of them to pass the mission. Kenji's missions can be found here too, marked as a K on the map. Back to Asuka for a paparazzi purge. Her and Maria have left on holiday as a reporter has been watching them and taking pictures. She says he's probably at the bay and to take a police boat to end him. Or maybe I could just hang out here and snipe his boat to death? I cannot, as he escapes. Then I drown trying to reach a boat of my own. It's not until my third try that I finally accomplish the first step of the mission. The police boat, the Predator, has its own cannons. I just chase him around the islands, being interrupted by loading screens until I blow up his boat with him on board. I retain so much momentum as I get out of the boat that I end up sprinting into the sea. Back to Asuka for payday for Ray. I catch her and Maria in a bit of a private moment. Maria's tied up inside while Asuka just sits outside and leaves her. Asuka says it's time for me to meet her source and the police. She gives me his payment for his most recent job. I have to get to the payphone in Torrington quickly for his instructions. I have 3.5 minutes and I get there in 1. He tells me to get to the payphone in West Belleville Park next. No extra time, it takes me another minute. Next phone is Liberty Campus. I get there with 30 seconds left and he tells me to get to another phone in South Belleville Park. I run out of time. I get it next time with 26 seconds to spare. Now I have to meet him in the toilet block in the park. No more timer, thankfully. I sprint there and meet Ray, giving him the money. He gives a little rant about how corrupt he is and tells me he has some work for me. With that mission passed, Ray is on the map, marked with an R. We're going to take a break from Asuka's missions right now and do some work for Ray, starting with Silence the Sneak. Ray's screaming about this guy McCaffrey who's taken more bribes than anyone else in the police. He's planning to turn in evidence of Ray's corruption in exchange for an honourable discharge. He's under armed protection in an apartment behind a car park in Newport. I have to destroy the place and take down everyone there so he can't talk to anyone. I drive over there to find the window open, so I throw a grenade in there and set it on fire. McCaffrey then passes right by me in his car and I get an instant wanted level 2. Like an idiot, I try running after his car and he gets away. Next time I park my own car in front of his garage, but despite getting it first time, I can no longer get the grenade in the window. Instead I end up killing myself with them. Third time it happens again. Fourth time I get the grenade in, but parking in front of his garage does nothing, he can just brute force through, so I chase him in a car myself. Only the police shoot the car to shit in a few seconds and my plan of having it blow up on McCaffrey doesn't work. So I steal the police car and keep going, but those 2 or 3 seconds it took to take that car are too much and he gets away. Fifth and sixth tries I blow myself up, seventh he gets away, and eighth I get busted. But on my ninth try I block his exit onto the streets with my car until it takes enough damage and explodes, taking him with it. Probably my most failed mission. I return to Ray for arms shortage. One of his old army friends runs a business in Rockford. He was attacked by the cartel and told they'd be back for some of his stock. Ray wants me to back him up, in return his friend will give me a discount on weapons. I've been here before, it's where I found my first hidden package on this island. I meet up with Phil Cassidy, who's missing an arm. We'll see him lose it in a later game. He lets me grab a large selection of weapons before the cartel shows up. I lose all my armor from a Molotov a few seconds in. Did you know that when someone is shooting you repeatedly, walking up to their face will get you killed? I learned that day. Second try, I use Molotovs myself and fry myself to death. Third time, I'm killed by a shotgun. Fourth time, I run around the back and pick people off one by one instead of charging them all at once. That's followed by a few grenades lobbed over the gate. After a few minutes silence, I go back out to see what's going on. The last guy got stuck in the wall, so I put him out of his misery and return to Phil. He implies he lost his arm in Nicaragua. You bloody liar. I can now buy weapons from him, including a rocket launcher. No more rare missions yet, so I return to Asuka for Two-Faced Tanner. Her and Maria are out shopping and left a note. The police source has said that one of their drivers is a strangely animated undercover cop who's useless out of his car. That description and the name Tanner are a jab at the Driver series. I call Driver a rival of GTA, but comparing their success, there's no contest. No reflection on the games, mind you. I've only properly played the first game where there was no player character, just cars. There's a tracer on his car, I just have to kill him. I drive down to Kenji's casino to see him leave and get in the car. I drive alongside and shoot out my window with the Uzi. This gives me an instant 4-star wanted level. I manage to just about fill his damage meter, but before I can gain that last tiny bit, the police run my car off the island and into the sea with me still inside. Some even follow me down. Next time, no pissing about. I get a rocket launcher from Cassidy and blow the guy up in seconds. No new Asuka mission yet, so I decide to move on to Kenji's missions. His first mission is Kambu Bustout. Despite Asuka's approval of Claude, Kenji isn't yet sure that he can be that helpful. A Yakuza Kambu is in custody awaiting a trial. He's very important and we need to get him out of there and drop him at the dojo at Bedford Point. First step is to steal a police car. I then get it rigged with a bomb and get inside the police station. I activate the bomb and park it to blow up the prison wall. The Kambu is now following me, but I have a 3-star wanted level. Stealing this armoured enforcer is a good way to keep the both of us alive though. I use the bribes at my hideout to get rid of them and drop him off at the dojo. He gets stuck running into a wall repeatedly, but it doesn't matter, I passed the mission. The next mission Kenji gives me, simply named Grand Theft Auto. Kenji wants to repay the kindness of the man who helped him out years ago. He likes cars and wants certain models for his collection. Kenji gives me the list and tells me to deliver those cars to the garage behind the car park in Newport. I have 6 minutes and the cars all have to be in mint condition. They're marked by blips on the map, but the first one I go to is actually the garage I need to drop them off at, so I wasted a minute and a half. By the time I grab a cheetah in Rockford, I have lost nearly half of my time. When I deliver it, 2.5 minutes left. Next is an Infernus in Espatria. It gets damaged, but lucky for me, there's a pain spray next to the garage. This is very lucky because the car catches fire right in front of it and I just barely get it fixed in time. But I have less than 50 seconds to get and bring back the last car, and I run out of time before I find it. The other car is a Stinger in Bedford Point. I get this one first and deliver it and manage to deliver the other two with over 50 seconds left. Third mission for Kenji is Deal Steal. The cartel have been ignoring requests to keep out of Yakuza business and are now negotiating with the Yardies to make things worse for them. With one of Kenji's men, I have to steal a Yardie car and kill everyone there from the cartel to ruin that deal. I find and steal a car and then pick up my contact in Espatria. The meeting is being held in the hospital car park in Rockford. I park in the marker and beep to get the deal going. The cartel get out of their car and I gun them down, take their briefcase and blow up their cars. I then take the briefcase back to the casino to pass the mission. Kenji's next mission is Shima. He wants me to collect the payments from all the businesses that pay the Yakuza protection money. The money is just left in briefcases floating above the ground. First is in Torrington, then Bedford Point, and I have to park at the third place in Belleville Park. The owner can't give me the money because another gang robbed him of it. Said gang is all the way in Portland, in Hepburn Heights. I drive by them, shooting them all and get the briefcase. Then it's just a long drive back with a police car on my arse for that shooting. But once I reach that blue marker, they can't stop me and by the time I leave, they've got bored and left. Last mission from Kenji is Smackdown. He's pissed off with me. My attempt at preventing the cartel and the Yardies from working together failed, and the Yardies are now selling spank on the streets. I have one last chance to wipe them out. I had to kill at least 8 Yardie dealers. It's pretty simple, I just drive around the city following the blips and flatten and or shoot them. I manage exactly 8 before the other dealers get off the streets, finishing the mission. With Kenji's faith in me restored and no more work from him, I return to Ray for Evidence Dash. He is a friend who is going to be prosecuted for some shady shit and photos exist of these actions. I need to ram the car containing the evidence and snatch it all up. Once I have all the evidence, I am to destroy the car. So this is just a simple case of catching up to the car, ramming it and grabbing all 6 pieces of evidence while the police try to arrest me. There's no time limit. I guess whoever has the evidence is just going for a long, lazy recreational drive. The final piece of evidence is a bit of a pain because it ends up halfway in the floor against a wall and the police are determined to make their cars occupy that same space. But once I get it, I flip the car using the tiniest little bump and torch for evidence. Suddenly there's now a mission marker marked D on the map, but I'll deal with that later. For now, the next mission Ray has for me is Gone Fishing. Now he wants me to kill his partner because he thinks he's a rat. He likes to fish on his boat near the lighthouse on Portland Rock. So I steal a police boat, drive out there, chase him a bit while shooting until he seals his fate by getting on land with no car nearby. This lets me chase him with an Uzi until he's dead. Next from Ray is Plaster Blaster. He comes up screaming at me. Somehow, that witness survived the many bullets I put in him in a place where he wouldn't be found for a while. He's being moved from the hospital in Rockford to make a statement, and if they get Ray, he'll drop Claude in it too. I ram his ambulance, filling the damage bar to 99%, but my car also catches fire on contact. Luckily, the police pull up and I can steal theirs. The guy falls out of the back of the ambulance, and it says a lot of these shoddy ambulances in this game that a guy reeled with bullets and a full body cast is more durable than the vehicle containing him. Even flipping my car on top of him and engulfing him in the explosion only does minuscule damage. Thanks to dangerous police driving, he actually takes 3 concurrent police car explosions to the face. But being just a little bit near 2 explosions myself kills me. He suddenly lost that high defense stat on the second try, as using his body as a ramp once kills him. And that's Ray's missions done for now. Now for that D, standing for Donald Love. He's found in Bedford Point and walking into the marker starts Liberator. He starts thanking me for dealing with that personal matter, and I'm not sure what he's on about. An old man he knows and considers valuable is being held hostage by the cartel in Spatria. It seems he was funding them and now they want more, but he won't pay, so he wants me to go and save his friend. I need one of their gang cars first so I can get in their hideout, so I steal myself a cartel cruiser and get down there. I had to do this much earlier for Hidden Package. I don't get very far when the camera obscures my view of my car, and when I get it back on screen, it's exploding with me in it. Next time I just get out of the car and run around shooting them all. The hostage is in one of the garages, being guarded by a single guy who takes me down all by himself. I'll skip ahead about 20 minutes to my 6th attempt, where I finally save the old man. I get him in my car and drop him off at Love's building. I walk back into the market to start Wakagashira Wipeout. Love wants to use a Yakuza cartel gang war to lower some real estate prices by having me kill Kenji. He's at a meeting at the top of that multi-story car park in Newport. I have to kill him in a cartel car to frame it on them. Good thing for me, I still have my cruiser from the last mission. By the way, you can do this mission before doing all of Kenji's missions, so if you kill him before doing them all, you miss out 100%. I drive to the top of the car park, take out all of Kenji's men, and watch him dodge a million bullets while standing still until one finally gets him. With Kenji dead, I now have to flee Newport and dump the car. I simply flip it off the roof and belt it until I'm out of the area. Even the police helicopter chasing me gives up the second I step foot out of Newport. You'd think killing my girlfriend's girlfriend's brother would come back to bite me, but while there are consequences, none of them are for me. I return to Donald for a drop in the ocean. He has a light aircraft passing the bay and dropping several illegal packages into the water that I have to pick up before anyone else. I have 2 minutes before the plane is in range to drop the packages. There are 6 in total, and each one I grab adds a star to my wanted level. My first attempt ends at 3 when one of the packages sinks. Next time I get it, but I have a 6-star wanted level, meaning there'll be tanks waiting for me in the streets. I get close to Love's building to drop them off, but a million cars run me over at once and the rest of my health gets shut out of me. Next time I run for my hideout and use the police bribes to make things much easier. Once the packages are delivered, I've passed the mission. Ray has a new mission for me too, but the last mission I passed just gave me access to the third island. So in the northwest of Staunton, I take the bridge going into Shoreside Dale, the smallest of the three. As soon as I cross over, I get Paige telling me there's missions at a payphone in Wichita Gardens. First thing as usual is to get the hidden packages out of the way. On the middle segment of the bridge that raises and lowers, I stand on it and wait for it to rise. At its highest, I can grab the 69th hidden package floating up in the sky. Now I can properly enter the island. The maps I've been using for hidden packages always start with the northernmost one and number them going south. So if you thought my previous package collecting route was very messy, that's why. I head all the way to the northwest to Cochrane Dam. The very first little building going out from the dam I run up to and behind for my 70th package. The AK-47 will now spawn on my hideout. Then going east, the second one also has a 71st package hidden behind it. Next I go south a little and drop down to the lower level of the dam. In the corner where the wall meets this building, I can find my 72nd hidden package. At this point I pause and see that I'm at 61%. I go south into Pike Creek, then west, north and east across a bridge into Cedar Grove. I drop down to the road below the bridge and follow it north to the other side of Cochrane Dam. Then it's up the first set of stairs I can find for my 73rd hidden package. West some more and up the stairs by the blue shipping containers to find a 74th package. Return to the road and get going north and then east back into Cedar Grove. Then south to the back door of his house for hidden package number 75. Then south and west into another back garden for the 76th package. Continuing east and inspecting all these houses, the 77th package is found on our front doorstep. I use a cartel cruiser to open the gate into the eastmost garden where I look in the pool for the 78th hidden package. To the east of that house, I take a big fall down to the northeastern edge of the island where I can find the 79th hidden package. Jumping in the sea here ends up booting me back to Staunton Island, so I've got a long trek back. As soon as I enter the Cochrane Dam area from the south, I turn west and get out of my car and get close to this building to see a package on the other side of this fence. I leave the area, run around the outside to find this ramp and do a bit of platforming to land on the other side of the fence to grab my 80th hidden package. 80 of them spawns a sniper rifle at my hideout. After this I head southwest into Pike Creek. I jump over this wall onto a roof containing my 81st hidden package. It's then east, south and west again to run around this building and find the 82nd hidden package behind the fence. Then back to Cedar Grove, but this time I turn right at the end of the bridge and follow the road downhill. At the second turn I drop down to the lowest road and move north to find hidden package number 83. I turn and move south into Wichita Gardens. Up this hill is a Shoreside Vale hideout. Running around the outside of this building, there's my 84th hidden package hidden behind a car. I then move south, east and jump over this railing to find the 85th hidden package in this doorway. A little southeast and between two more buildings is the 86th. I then blow myself up to get back to the hospital in Pike Creek faster. My 87th hidden package is around the back of the hospital. East from the hospital, I use a car to jump over this wall and land in front of the 88th hidden package. Further south is this large warehouse with stairs leading to the roof. I can jump off that roof to another roof where the 89th hidden package is collected. Seconds later, I drop down and find the 90th hidden package. The M16 will now be available at my hideout. Just 10 left. I exit and follow the road south and east towards Francis International Airport. I pass these billboards and find a dirt path north into Wichita Gardens. Underneath this broken bridge, I find my 93rd hidden package. Now it's time to actually enter the airport, just west after coming off the bridge into Shoreside. I drive around the north end and find the 92nd package hiding behind a fire truck. I keep following this path west and then south a little through a gate to find the 93rd package. I drive through the barrier and here is where all the planes are. I go to the most northwest plane outside where my 94th package is chilling under it. Then south past another plane, the nearest one to the southeast has the 95th underneath it. To the southeast at the very end of the runway, I can drop down a little and get my 96th hidden package. Then a long run west and I can drop down again for my 97th package. Going off a little, up the stairs of this helipad, I can get the 98th package right next to this helicopter. After this, I leave the way I came and take the road going south instead. The 99th hidden package is behind the southernmost billboards outside the airport. Then it's east, up the stairs and down into the subway where the final hidden package is waiting for me. Collecting all 100 will now have a rocket launcher spawn at my hideout. It also rewards me a lot of money. Now comes something hard. In the southeast of the airport, I can find a plane, the Dodo. Thanks to its very small wings, it is very difficult to fly. This is a problem because the Dodo is the final vehicle I need for Portland's import-export. One attempt ends with me in the sea. One time I try just driving it there like a car, but I have to go through all of Staunton Island to get to Portland and it gets destroyed on the way. It takes me half an hour to finally make a Dodo survive to Portland Harbour. Completing the list at Portland's import-export grants me another massive cash reward and now for free I can request any of the vehicles I gave them be delivered to me. But Portland isn't the only place with an import-export. There's one in Shoreside Vale too. It's in the northwest in the Cochrane Dam area. I start by dropping off the perennial I drove back here from Portland Harbour in. Just around the corner, I see the Landstalker that I also drop off. Then right outside the garage is a Stallion for me to steal and park in there. In Pike Creek, I take a taxi and drop that off. That's a quarter of the list completed in about 4 minutes. In the airport car park, I steal a Sentinel and drop that off. Also from the airport car park is a Manana. I drop that off. A third of the list done. Again in the airport car park is an Infernus. That's 7 of them delivered. In Cedar Grove, I steal a Banshee and deliver that to complete half of the list. Then right outside the garage, I steal a cabby. That's 9. Back in Cedar Grove, I hijack a Karuma and get my 10th car delivered there. Also in Cedar Grove is a Cheetah to steal and drop off. Back to the airport car park for an Esperanto. When I drop that off, it's 3/4 of the list complete. All the way back in Portland, in Hepburn Heights, I can steal a BF Injection outside Misty's house. It's in surprisingly good shape by the time I've driven it across all three islands. In one of the gardens in Cedar Grove, I steal a Stinger. When that's delivered, it's just 2 left. I go all the way to a car park in Espatria for an Idaho and deliver that to them. That's 1 left, but I don't deliver it just yet. Around the corner from my hideout is a Rumpo that when entered starts the optional mission, Rumpo Rampage. 2 minutes to use an RC car to blow up as many gang cars as I can. This is just like the other RC missions I've done and I pass with 3 kills as my record. Next on the list is my final firefighter session. During this, the game spawns me the final car needed for Shoreside Vale's import-export, the Stretch. When I drop that off, the list is finished and like with Portland's, I can have any of those 16 vehicles delivered to me for free. When I put out my 20th fire here, that's 20 on all three islands and a flamethrower can now be picked up at my hideout. My hideouts aren't complete though. Next is Vigilante on Shoreside. Once again the pulse trick is in use. 20 criminals killed gets me the last 2 police bribes at my hideout. So that's my hideout fully decked out. All weapons, adrenaline, a full set of 6 police bribes. Next up on the list is Shoreside Vale's unique jump stunts. This place has 8, like Portland.
Ace, two, scrap, one, four. 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 Ace, two, scrap, Grab wants four. Grab wants four. Wants the hot four. Five wants four.
Check me out, John.
Nine a winner. Got a hot hand. Place your bets, ladies and gentlemen. Nine a winner. Got a hot hand. Place your bets, ladies and gentlemen. Four and he made us the hard way. Hey, the front line takes the hard. You have a shooter and a good one. Coming out for a new point. Get your bets down, ladies and gentlemen. He's a rolling point as nine. Place nine. Place nine. Eight shooting for nine. Five shooting for nine. He's a rolling point as nine. Place nine. Eight shooting for nine. Five shooting for nine. Who wants to come? Six to point.
Check me out, John.
Nine a winner. Got a hot hand. Place your bets, ladies and gentlemen. Place your bets. Who wants to come? Six to point. Who wants to come? Six to point. Place your bets, ladies and gentlemen.
And that is all 20 unique stunt jumps in the game. Next is this island's off-road mission. In Wichita Gardens, there's another Patriot that when entered starts a side mission, Gripped. 5 minutes, 20 checkpoints. This one especially is a pain thanks to some ridiculously steep hills I have to somehow not fall down. Like the rest, it takes me around 40 minutes, and I never have to do another one of these again after it's passed. Next on the list are the last rampages in the game. That last one took over an hour, so I take a break from rampages, saving the last one. Next is the emergency crate. I start by taking an enforcer from the Staunton Island police station. I drive to Portland Harbour and park it under the crane to pick it up. This is the emergency vehicle equivalent of the import-export. Why am I waiting until now to start this Portland set side quest? I simply forgot about it until this point. The next one is a police car. They're everywhere, I don't need to show you how I got it. Same for the fire truck and the ambulance. From Phil Cassidy's place in Staunton, I grab a Barracks OL. This has been here the whole time, I just never use it for anything other than a failed attempt at blocking his gate to keep out his attackers. Next vehicle starts with me rocket launching my way to wanted level 5. As soon as I see the FBI rock up, I run through all my police bribes, steal the FBI car, ram it into my garage to make it mine forever, and save so if anything goes wrong, I can just reload and get it back. But he's fine, and I get the FBI car there on the first try. I do the same strategy again, but this time I get myself up to wanted level 6. I wait for a tank to show up, get the bribes, and steal it. Of course, that puts my wanted level back up to 1, and I'm easily busted. This takes a few tries, but after a while, I have control of the Rhino. It's a lot of fun. Not only can I fire missiles from the turret, but any cars that so much as brush past me explode on contact. It's also heavily armoured and can only explode from being flipped, and that's exactly what happens as I'm going through Staunton Island. A single car makes my tank do somersaults. It takes a long time, and it hurts to just give a tank away for free, but I do it. That's the last one, and I can now get any emergency vehicle from the harbour for free. Back to some story. I return to Ray for his final mission, Marked Man. The CIA have an interest in Spank and don't like our interference with the cartel. Ray needs to flee Liberty City, so I have to get him to the airport. A roadblock is that the CIA had the bridge to Shoreside Vale under surveillance, so I need another way there. Or it would be, if I wasn't escorting Ray in a tank. I thought it might slip under the radar. I mean, it worked, and I got Ray to the airport with over 40 seconds remaining. He gives me a key to a lockup with some cash and supplies as thanks for helping him escape. However, I have to reach the lockup first to finish the mission, and I get busted while turning around because the tank reverses slowly. Second time I drop him off, I built up a 5-star wanted level. But I speed myself up by pointing the turret behind me and firing to give myself a little boost. I return to my hideout in Staunton to use up all my bribes and leg it the rest of the way there. The lockup is in Newport, and as soon as I open it, he sends me one last page saying he's going to Miami. And I don't know, that'd just put you in the territory of Tommy Vercetti if he's still alive. There's a bulletproof Patriot in here too. This will be very helpful for the final rampage. And with that final rampage finished, that's every bit of side content in the game complete. The rest of this will be purely story missions. I return to Staunton Island and get my next mission from Donald Love, Grand Theft Aero. The packages the plane was dropping were a decoy, what he wanted most was on the plane itself. The plane was seized by port authorities though, and he had to pay them off, so I have to go to the airport in Shoreside Vale to pick up his stuff. I go there, but the plane is surrounded by the cartel, so I hang back and start sniping. Once they're all gone, I get on the plane to find the packages missing. There's a cartel van with an arrow above it, so I blow it up. That van was the only lead, so I failed the mission. I'm supposed to approach the van to see the logo for the Panlantic Construction Company on the side, so I drive to Staunton Island's construction site. I read about the place killing people with rockets and grenades, messing myself up quite a bit in the process. Once everyone's dead, I take the lift up this tower, where Catalina and Miguel are getting ready to leave. Miguel is willing to give up the package, saying there's no other choice. Catalina shoots him in the back and runs away. Asuka also shows up to claim Miguel, believing he's the one who killed Kenji thanks to me using a cartel car. She decides to torture him for information and tells me to stop by later. Claude simply leaves, ignoring Miguel's begging to not leave him with her. Last step is to drop the package off at Love's to pass the mission. Asuka is back on the map, but she'll have to wait. Love's next mission is escort service. I have to escort his friend while he takes whatever was in the package to be authenticated. I have to make sure they get to Pike Creek, so I just have to follow this van. An issue is that whoever is driving that van drives like me, taking many shortcuts that don't help but go through lampposts and break things. We actually do reach Pike Creek, but the absolute idiot can't stay on the road, ends up on the inside of a wall and just rams himself into it. So when I check what the hell he's doing, a cartel car comes up from behind and flips my car next to his, somehow not getting them both blown up. But he still can't move and slowly wrecks the car against the wall, failing me the mission. Second time he just barely gets there and parks in his garage. A few more bumps and it would be another failure. Love's next mission is decoy. SWAT teams have cordoned off the area surrounding Love's friend and his package. I have to grab the van and act as a decoy while his friend escapes with the package. So it's back to Pike Creek to get in that van. This gives me an instant 6-star wanted level and a 3-minute timer to survive while the other guy gets away. The security car is quite low, but it isn't much of a problem because the police and SWAT teams drive like maniacs and struggle to even hit me. The main problem is bullets. They chew through my van's health in about 30 seconds. The consolation is the security car's explosion takes out many nearby police cars too. On my second attempt, I lead them to the airport and hide in a hangar. For some reason, the police won't follow me out here, and with the hangar in the way, the helicopters can't shoot me. So I just wait out the last minute and a half until it gets smart and shoots at me from the other side. But at that point, I have 30 seconds left, so I just drive around a bit until time runs out and I pass the mission. I return to Love to start Love's disappearance. It's not a mission. Claude shows up to find that Donald Love has skipped town. And that's it, we're done with him. Now it's time to do some more work for Asuka. At this point, I'm at 91% completion, so we're getting there. From now on, Asuka gives me her missions at the construction site. First mission she gives me here is bait. She's still beating Miguel for information. he does reveal that Catalina is so afraid of Claude that she has three death squads around the city purely for hunting him down. I have to bait them all to Pike Creek, where the Yakuza will be waiting for them. Pretty much as soon as I enter Pike Creek, a car starts chasing me. I just lead it up here, where they all get killed. That's about all there is. The death squads aren't that aggressive, and there's only to lead them to the Yakuza. A nice easy mission. Next mission for Massacre is Espresso to Go. She's still beating Miguel. Catalina's reach with Spank is further than first thought. The cartel has a front company called the Kappa Coffee House that sells Spank through the street stalls. My next job is to destroy them. Once I destroy my first stall, I have 8 minutes to destroy the other 8 before the cartel gets their warning out to the rest of the pushers. This is a tough one because they're all over the city, including St. Mark's, where the Mafia still haven't forgiven me for Salvatore. I killed Salvatore on the 13th of October, and the recording for this mission was done on the 17th. It's been 4 days, get over it. A bad idea was to use a rocket launcher with a policeman next to me. The explosion knocked me down, and he used the chance to bust me. On my second try, I get the St. Mark's stall first, since the timer doesn't start until one is destroyed. This not only gets the most dangerous one out of the way, but it makes my route much cleaner, as I can now cover all three islands from east to west. By the time I get to the last stall in Shoreside Vale to destroy it, I still had over a minute and 20 seconds left. With that mission done, it's back to Asuka for SAM. It's been a while since we've seen Maria, and now she's gotten into the torture as well. She's managed to get some info from Miguel. A plane landing in the airport in 2 hours time full of Spank for Catalina. Asuka wants me to avoid airport security by taking a boat up there. Then she wants me to blow up the plane and take the cargo. I start with a timer of 3.5 minutes. I get cocky and think I can outsmart the plane by just driving to the airport and using a rocket launcher. The mission failed. Turns out I was aiming at the wrong plane, so my stubbornness still wins out when I try the rocket launcher again. It still doesn't work, but I still don't give up. Thing is, I get followed into the airport by the cartel and gunned down on my third attempt. Fourth try, I finally shoot the bastard, but still fail because it's not what I'm supposed to do. But then I do it again on my fifth try and it doesn't fail me this time. I get to pick up all the cargo and have to get back to the construction site with a 4-star wanted level. Seems easy enough and I'm doing well just on foot, but then my game freezes. The only time this happened during the entire playthrough. So I have to do it all again. But it's so dark, I don't notice I've driven myself into the sea and drown. But in the end, I manage to make it back and get a cutscene named Ransom. Catalina has Maria and will kill her if I don't hand over 500 grand at Cedar Grove. She's also killed Asuka and Miguel. 500 grand is nothing to me right now. Also, who's paying me for completing the mission? Did Claude just loot Asuka's corpse? The final mission is marked as a sea on the map, but there's some more to do first. I completely forgot about that King Courtney guy, so I finally check out that payphone at Liberty Campus to start Bling Bling Scramble. The Yardies want a driver, so I have to go to the waste ground opposite the stadium and wait for the others. It's another checkpoint race, and if I win, I'll get some work. So I go there. How this one works is that whoever gets to the checkpoint first wins a grand, and whoever gets the most checkpoints wins. Thankfully, it isn't against the rules to use a tank. I just killed the competition for an easy chill race, rocketing down the rows, boosting myself with turret fire. I end with 12 out of 15 checkpoints and easily win. Courtney's next mission is Uzi Rider. Now he knows I'm capable, next is seeing if I can be trusted. Two of his guys show up and I have to help them kill some Diablos in Hepburn Heights. So once I'm there, he's just driving around and killing until 10 Diablos are dead, after which I need to return the guys to Yali territory. I drop them off in Newport, having gained their trust. Third mission from Courtney is Gang Car Roundup. He wants me to steal some cars from rival gangs to cause some friction between them. He wants a Mafia Sentinel, a Yakuza Stinger, and a Diablo Stallion for this. They need to be dropped off at a garage in Newport in good condition. The Stinger I find in the construction site at Fort Staunton. Asuka may be dead, but one of the gang cars is still around. I then grab the Stallion in Hepburn Heights. It's strange how much smaller Portland is than it seemed when I was a kid. At 9 years old, Portland alone felt like the entire Breath of the Wild map. Of course, the Sentinel is in St. Mark's, so I'm not taking any chances. I roll up there with a tank, trying not to blow up any sentinels I might see. I grab one outside Salvatore's house. I mean, no one's living there anymore, so it's not like there's anyone to give a shit. After nearly smashing it up on a cliff edge, I deliver it to the garage and finish the mission. The last mission from Courtney is Kingdom Come. He tells me to get over to Bedford Point. There's a stash he needs hidden in an old car. I have 90 seconds to get there. Using the tank was a bad idea, as the police keep swarming me and slowing me down, making me run out of time. I get to the car next time, and inside is a letter from Catalina. It seems she's bought out the Yardies with Spank. A spanked up suicide bomber shows up, but the bomb goes off just before he can get me. I get back in my tank and take out all the bomber's vehicles. That's where the Courtney mission line ends, and our relationship with him and the Yard is broken. Just one more line of missions before I can tackle the final one. Around the corner from the Shoreside Vale hideout is the payphone for the D-Ice missions, starting with Uzi Money. D-Ice is the leader of the Red Jacks. He complains about a rival gang wearing purple, the Nines, that is gaining influence selling Spank and making the Red Jacks look weak. I have 2.5 minutes to drive-by kill 20 purple Nines. They say that only drive-by Uzi shootings count, but drive-by tank shootings absolutely count too. I guess because I also have an Uzi equipped while I'm doing it. I run out of time on my first attempt, but get it the second time. Town, you fucking. Next, the ice mission is Toy Minator. The Nines are still selling spank and have armoured cars. There's a van park nearby that puts me in another RC car mission, this time to destroy armoured cars. There's four of them around Shoreside Vale and some are quite the trek to get to. I don't know what happened with the last one though. He said I had two left, but passed me the mission when I destroyed just one. I'll take it though. Rigged to Blow is Deice's third mission. Someone rigged his car with a bomb. Apparently, the car is his entire image, as without it, he loses all his credibility. I have to pick up and take it to the garage in St. Mark's to get it defused. I have 6 minutes, the car is nearby and I have a detonation meter. Get damaged too much and the car goes up in flames. Somehow, I get to the garage through St. Mark's without a mafia filling it with billions of bullets. Now to take it back, but the car has to be in perfect condition when I return it, so I need to get it repaired a couple times. A few times, a slight bump has me turning around and going back to the pay and spray. It takes a few attempts to drop it off where I got it from without a single scratch and pass the mission. Next mission is Bullion Run. A Federal Reserve flight crashed at the airport, spilling platinum all over the place. I have 6 minutes from when I first get in a car. Every piece I pick up slows down my car, and they don't count in my toll until they've been dropped off at this garage. My first visit to the garage has me drop off 18 pieces. Then my second visit has me drop off all the rest. Just one more mission from Deice left. It's called Rumble. The Nine's numbers have reduced, but they still want to take on the Jacks. He has an excuse to keep himself out of the big fight and just leave me and his little brother to it. I first have to meet his brother, who tells me where it's gonna happen. It's in Cedar Grove, low down by the sea where I did the off-road mission. We were only allowed bats and there's way more of them, so I get beaten to death. I manage it next time, finishing all work for Deice. Just the final mission left. I go to the mansion in Cedar Grove to start the exchange. Claude hands over the money at the gate to get let in. Catalina asks him if he gave her the money to get back Maria or to get his revenge on her. She's not going to let me have either, and when she gets the money, orders her men to kill me. We then get a very awkward slow motion punch and I'm left with just a pistol and 7 minutes to chase down Catalina. I kill everyone in the garden, steal a cruiser and leave for a chopper to fly overhead that I have to follow to reach Catalina. He leads me over to Cochrane Dam, but it tricks me into dropping down to the wrong level, so I just quit and reload to save time. I'm supposed to enter at the eastern entrance to the middle level. I can tell because as I approach it, my car gets obliterated by cartel fire. It's fine though, because I had the time to take a detour to my safe house and get all my weapons back. As soon as the cruisers appear in the distance, I go to town with the rocket launcher. However, I missed one guy who, as I get closer, annihilates me. On my third try, I'm not fucking around. I pull the tank I was using for those de-ice missions out of my garage and wipe them all out. The helicopter lands near Catalina, who plans to use it for her escape. I reach the stairs with full health, but the combination of exploding a rocket too close to myself and an enemy with a flamethrower takes 150 health from me. I have no choice but to ignore everyone else and try to shoot down the helicopter, but they shoot me down first. Next time I hang back, and I think I have Catalina in my sights with the rifle, so I shoot. Turns out it was Maria I just killed, failing again. Catalina is on the helicopter. Next time goes much smoother. I snipe the last of Catalina's men just in time for... Claude walks away with Maria, who keeps on talking about how much fun they're gonna have and how much she loves Claude, and she just keeps rambling as we hear a news report describing the events of the final mission from the perspective of the citizens. The police also have no idea what caused all the chaos, so Claude can get away unscathed. Maria complains again about a broken nail and ruined hair, and we don't see what happens, but we hear her get cut off mid-sentence by the sound of the gunshot. Whether Claude killed her for all the trouble she caused him or he was firing a warning shot to shut her up is left up to the player's interpretation. I think both are equally valid, it just depends on what you see from the completely silent Claude and how much of a monster you see him as. Despite being the first game in the 3D universe, it's the final one chronologically, as no others were set later, before the reboot in GTA 4, so we will likely never get an answer. Now that I've 100%ed the game without cheats, I allow myself a chance to cut loose. Weapon and tank cheats aren't that useful for me considering I can get those things easily, but my favourite was the random model swap cheat. There's something endlessly entertaining about punching people with the rigid shopping bags glued to your hand if you got one of those. Grand Theft Auto 3, even 20 years later, is a fucking massive game and I'm never covering this much of a game in a single standalone video ever again. The very base level of all the 3D GTA games is always fun, just running around causing chaos. While it's satisfying going through the story, building up your connections and just betraying everybody, it's not my favourite story campaign in the series. Another issue I have is that Portland is the most interesting, largest and most fun island to mess around in. But the gang heat system stops you from being able to enjoy yourself as much and leaves you with the still fine but not as fun Staunton Island and the minuscule Shoreside Vale. That having been said, Portland itself is just a lot of fun and makes the game on its own. To be honest, my biggest complaint is the lack of a map in the pause menu. Despite being completely silent, there is something about Claude that makes him compelling. I think part of it is the design. Normally it would just be seen as generic, but it just works. Plus, having no personality does make him relatable to me as a fellow person with no personality. As for my complaints, a lot of my issues will be fixed in the next game anyway. While I do think GTA 3 has been outdone by later games, I still think it manages to avoid being obsolete and provide something of value. For one thing, it's the only 3D universe game to be set in the modern day. Of course, that modern day is now 20 years old, which is unthinkable, but every game from now on until the reboot is set in the past. I think it speaks to the quality that, despite the complaints I had, it will still be ranked quite high. So yeah, this is the last of those initial games I recorded in 2018 before I finally set on what I wanted these videos to be. No more bonus episodes after this, next will be episode 16, and the episode numbering will no longer be confusing. After this, all games I have recorded currently were done this year. There will also be another change. With the exception of those three episodes after the personal stuff happened, for each episode I've been uploading a video a day from the Monday of that week. That will not be happening after now. Making up to 4 videos at once is proving to be unsustainable, and quadrupling my workload is just slowing me down and demoralising me. From now on, a single video goes up when it is done, regardless of whether the rest of the episode is finished. I will still be grouping multiple videos under one episode as I feel it will make my progress in terms of amount of games 100%ed easier to follow. Because it's been getting ridiculous in the past. For example, episode B3. The Metroid video was finished almost 3 months before it went up because I was slowly working on the other 3 parts and balancing it with recording the games for episodes 10 and 11. That's just not helping. So I think this will be better for the channel, better for the audience so they're not bombarded with a new video days in a row, sometimes with multiple long ones, but also better for me, mentally and motivationally. It's easy to sit down and decide, I have to script, record and edit a video over the next 2 days, than it is to sit down and say, I have to script, record and edit 4 videos over the next 2 or 3 weeks if I want to get an episode out a month as I've been doing all year. And also, thanks to my uploading schedule, it has to be done before the final Monday of the month. I'm aware these last 4 bonus episodes haven't been the usual 4 videos, but they've still been long. This single video is going to take more time and effort than the entirety of, say, episodes 12 or 13. Even my 8 video long episode 15 didn't take as long as this one video will. By the way, if this video missed August, it's not because I slacked getting it made. My 2 hour 20 minute Dragon Ball Z Budokai video took 5 days to upload, and this video will also be pretty long, so if I miss August, blame my upload speed. Yeah, that's it.